I'm leaving, getting the fuck out of Colorado, which I'm leaving as a fugitive because of officer, let me get the ticket here, Officer Weiskel from Durango, so cobbled, I hate him, I can't even see his name on the ticket, which he gave me yesterday morning at 9 o'clock in the morning for going 36 miles an hour in a 25 zone. So I was coming down from my campsite and went through it 36 miles an hour through a zone. It's a speed trap. He knew it. It was bullshit. This is the fourth time I've been stopped on the trip. The only thing that's clear for sure is that this country is a police state. I was stopped for a wrong turn signal. I was stopped for being lost in downtown Iowa City. I was over 13 miles over by a cop who was exactly like Cheney in Montana, Wyoming. And now I was going 11 miles over in a 36 miles in a 25 zone. And I get a ticket. And if I get another ticket in the state of Colorado, then I have to pay both tickets. This way I'm just can send them the $140. And it won't go on my record if I call the number that he kept on telling me I have to call. I only hope that the karma catches up with this son of a bitch.
Where did it all begin?
Here with splendor.
Dare to live until the very last. Dare to live, forget about the past. Dare to live, giving something of yourself to others, even when it seems there's nothing more.
Ma se tu vedessi l'uomo davanti al tuo portone che dorme avvolto in un cartone, se tu ascoltassi il mondo una mattina senza il rumore della pioggia, che puoi creare con la tua voce, tu pensi i pensieri della gente, poi di Dio c'è solo Dio. Vivere, nessuno mai ce l'ha insegnato, vivere, non si può vivere senza passato. È bello anche se non l'hai chiesto mai, una canzone ci sarà, qualcuno che la canterà.
Perché
non vivi questa sera? Perché non vivi ora?
Perché?
Perché?
Perché? Perché? Perché? Perché? Perché? Perché?
was 66 years old. I'm a teacher at Columbia College in DePaul. And I used to be in show business.
I'm known for writing Revenge of the Nerds, which is a very strange thing to be known for.
And I didn't have, you know, just 3 months off like this. And I thought, well, you know, what am I going to do? I could just sit home and be bored, or I could do something. So I decided to go to all the most beautiful spots in the United States. And I'll just, I'll park my car there, and I'll sleep in the back seat. And I'll get up in the morning, and I'll be there. And I thought, well, okay, and then I can have my internet stuff with me. And if they've got AT&T hookup or whatever, then I can have wifi, because I have the hot personal spot on my phone for wifi. So then I can connect my sling box so I can have my television at home with my clicker in my tent wherever I am, as long as there's AT&T service. And if they have Wi-Fi, then you can have as much data as you want. So you could do anything. I'd have my books. I'd have my music. I'd be able to write. I'd have Skype. I could talk to Duffy in Shanghai from my tent for free. I mean, this is the new world. This is Wi-Fi tent camping. I thought, you know what? I'm going to do it. So here is my first night camping, or roughing it. Here's my tent. Here's my bed. There is my owner's pier. Their boat is right there. Here's the view. This is the bay.
But the 2 days with my friends were over. It was time to go into the real woods, to really camp, to put up my own tent. I was scared. I really was scared. And where was I going to take a shit? And there'd be bears. Bears could really kill me.
And I talked to my sister-in-law, and she said, no, you need a layer between you and the air. And so you have to have a tent. So I said, okay. So I went to the store. I went to Best Buy. I went to Sport Authority. And they had everything. It was laid out in perfect rows, exactly what you had to have. And I had camped when I was 12 years old at camp. And so I actually knew a little bit about, you know, a tent or how to light a fire or how to cook a meal. And, you know, and how to hang out at a lake or a river. And then the rivers are great. I love hanging out at rivers. And so picked out a tent. It was $110. It went up in 1 minute, like 1 minute and 20 seconds, the tent went up. But the notches didn't go into the hole. So the whole thing might fall down during a storm in the middle of the night. And I'm not sure how to get the notches into the hole.
Apparently the campsite I had picked was in a spot I could only stay in for a day. And the wonderful forest ranger, Mrs. Sanders, moved me to a spot you can reserve and stay in for 2 weeks if you want to, and it was right on the ocean front in Maine. She said it was a miracle.
Here is the view from my tent. And here is my tent. Sleeping bags in, looking comfy. And then I am sitting,
eating an Italian sub
and watermelon with my new knife. Now, my light, it's raining. It went from that beautiful sunny day to raining. I didn't know it could rain. inside, had my chair inside.
And so I spent my first actual night sleeping in the tent. Thank you. Thank you.
Well, it's time to get up. It's time to get up. It's time to get up in the morning. Had a lovely night. Actually, the cold was not a problem. I would say that warm is a bigger problem than cold. There is a rock that's trouble. I was angling downhill. That was difficult. This will all have to be fixed today. As we do in camping, we improve each day.
And now, it's time for the first campfire. The lighting of the sterno hopefully will heat the water in the pot and make the coffee. The sterno has been lit. The pot is sitting on top of it. Whether or not it becomes hot is still in question. It would appear that the sterno has, in fact, heated the water. And now it is time for the traditional cup of coffee. Con azúcar, por favor. Just like Starbucks. Ooh, did I make it too hot? In my tent, it's a nice day out for camping, and I decided to start out by watching television. I realized that I could hang my television from the hooks in the ceiling, which is a tremendous opportunity.
Here's today's adventure.
I've hit the first problem. We like to call them hurdles in the camping business. The bed won't deflate. Am I doing it incorrectly? I don't think so. I've read the directions many times, I've gone over and over. Like I say, we refer to this as a hurdle.
Squadrons pass me by. No pipe did hum, no battle drum.
So to all those naysayers who thought I couldn't camp, here I'm handing in this receipt, which means aren't I officially a camper?
Camper.
And I've done it for 5 days, and I am now a camper.
Thank you.
Camping is not a perfect art. Oftentimes mistakes are made, and then it's important to improvise or come up with another approach, like for this deflated bed. Unable to deflate the bed, it had become a problem. So it's necessary to think, you know, use natural goods, maybe tie together reeds and leaves. I came up with this to solve the solution.
With their long
During the stop at L.L. Bean, I decided to go with the hand pumped.
That's what the real camper does. Innovation. This is easier to handle because you're solid blow up. You're easy to deflate. Now, let's see. The true test will be maybe it won't have the comfort of the double edge. That's going to become clear. But look how easy I can manipulate it into the... site at the Wild Duck Campgrounds, site 7. Wild Duck on the sign. Here's my space, and I have a little table. Up there are the luxury suites, so I'm almost like in luxury, but not. I decided to just relax. I'm going to try and watch 14 hours of television, then go into Portland, and I have a sunset sail. And so I'm out here with my books, my magazine, my electric nose thing. You know, a lot of you were complaining about the boogers in my nostril in one of the previous videos, and I personally would like to take this moment to apologize to all. Last night was a tremendous storm, and I was able to weather it. And this morning, a veteran camper, I could tell he'd done it all. Came up to me and said, nice camping, kid.
For I parted then with valiant men whom I never shall see more. But to and fro in my dreams
Portland, Maine was amazing. Cool, hip, young kids in a really neat city. But it was time to go into the wilderness, the real wilderness, Big Eddy. 74 miles north and 17 miles on a logger's highway with rocks and potholes. And, you know, you couldn't even drive on the damn thing. I was going into the real wilderness now. I was challenging myself, and I was scared. And there were real bears and elk.
I'm leaving civilization. I could be without phone service for 2 or 3 days. So if I never see you again, I want you to know that, well, it wasn't that good. Well, there were a lot of great times, but then there were bad, not that many bad times. There were much more. There were more great times, but there was, you know. But no, it was good. All right, my tent was up in 15 minutes or less. Here you got rafters coming right by my. See, right there's rafters, and here's the river. There's a nice rapid. Coming out here. There's the rapids. Tough. Splendor.
Big Eddy was wonderful. Raw wilderness, and I was making it.
This is it. I just wanted to sit by a river.
And this was a great one.
I don't know if you can see that. That's right outside the window. This guy's fishing.
another boat right there. There's the rapid. There. It's just not a good area to sit and enjoy yourself. Read a book.
Sitting in my tent, watching the river and the white top. It's unusual to be able to sit, that the actual chair is in the tent. It's very unusual. A lot of campers don't do that.
I'm about to make a tremendous mistake. It's raining, and I'm going to walk up from Roaring Brook parking lot to Chimney Pond. I've been assured by two experts that I will be fine. I intended to walk 5.5 miles to the Appalachian Trail, but a fellow hiker said that I shouldn't because I'm wearing jeans and rubber boots and a backpack. And I've listened to the person and I've given up going to the Appalachian Trail.
Going to Sandy Pond
instead of the Appalachian Trail. It's part of the sacrifice that one makes when camping. After all, if one can't listen to the advice of a fellow camper,
who can one listen to?
Decision time. I'd already gone 0.7 miles. I could go ahead for 1.3. I could go back, and I elected to go back. As I elected to go back, that meant it would be 1.4 mile hike, which was enough. I liked the wooden things that I walked on, pieces of lumber, because it gave me camping confidence, camping esteem, if you will, that I was in the right direction. I was on the right path. And now I'm going to take that path back to my car and get the hell out of here. Just because these are the boards that you walk on, it doesn't cheapen it. I'm back. I did it. I did it. I have officially walked 1.4 miles in an official national park that I paid $14 to enter. And I feel like I'm an Anthony Bourdain on bad wifi camping. And now if you add in the two hikes at Le Moyne State Park, then I'm well into the threes. And it's only my third week. One of the things that I didn't take into consideration is that there is weather.
It began to rain a lot. And as Lewis and Clark didn't have Wi-Fi, but I did, and I looked into the weather forecast, and New England was blanketed with rain for 10 days. The only nearest glimpse of sun I could see was in Wisconsin and Upper Michigan.
I intended to trick you and be in my wetsuit and be going on the rafting trip, but Dave, the leader, said to me I was correct, that I should not go on the trip. He took me aside and said, don't tell me the other, but you're making a smart decision. And so I leave the rafting trip. Well, I made it to Lake Winnipeskowee. The rain situation is much better here. Should be a great day tomorrow. And so I fled from the rain and head for the sun. I'm gonna go to Upper Michigan.
Or Wisconsin.
A journey of 1,000 miles.
Thank you. halfway home, so I decided to stop there instead of staying in Buffalo. I stayed at a Koa family campground, which was dissimilar to staying at Chuck E. Cheese. Literally, I went to my campsite, and there was an amusement park behind it with a train that came by. And my neighbor was a six-year-old girl who was having her birthday party. And her parents were there, certain that I was a pedophile.
So here's the amusement park next to my tent. So the train comes by. I had a lovely shot of it earlier. Little choo-choo train that comes right by here. But I blew it. It didn't turn out good. You know, in camping, you don't catch everything.
Here is a shot of the six-year-old birthday girl with her butterfly wings and her extremely troubled mother. Throughout the evening, more and more relatives arrived to protect her while I went to the casino in downtown Niagara Falls. But here is the whistle from the train.
I was then deceived by Molly O, the lily of the west.
Now this was camping.
To the last part of the first half of the trip, we're putting up our tent at Wagon Trail Tenting Compound Campground. And okay, we're gonna time me. Okay, so ready, go. Are you timing me?
Yes.
Lay that out. Right.
What's the date?
Extend each leg. There's four of them. Two, three, notice how I know what I'm doing, and I'm not giving any instructions. Okay, now you have to, this is, you put the, it's like a, right here, so you pull the umbrella up to that notch. Ooh, the guideline. So. Oh, notch is in.
Good.
Notch in, three notches in, moments away. Uh-oh, where's that notch? There it is, all the notches are in. Pop it up.
Well, beautiful.
How much time?
A minute and 20 seconds.
For our day's activity, we've decided to get killed on a bike trail. Here is the first fire. The lighting of the first fire. And so the first fire, sensational as was suspected, is the fire starter cheating? I don't think so.
Here is...
The first time I'm ashamed of our tent. As this incredible tent moved in next to us, and the fire stopped. So the fire starter was everything, and is cheating. Marsha has invaded my campsite. She's sweeping the floor, and she's also put up a clothesline. And the fire is working now, and the new beach chair is enjoying it. We are unable to make the fires. This is the fire starter caused this. We don't know whether it will hold or not. Marsha feels it will start up again. That's when it's one of the great joys of life, the many surprises that surprise us, surprisingly. Mistakes happen. Here's Marsha dropping all the chicken into the pit and ruining our dinner, except for the canned corn and peas and vegetables that have been nuked. The burnt chicken has been washed off and cooked. The fire was fantastic. We're in our dining room with our two chairs, the new beach chair that's doing so beautifully, the old chair. And there's our meal on paper. We have chicken, tenders, corn, and peas and carrots in the handy containers that are pull-off and don't need a can opener. The tent humiliation is growing. Look at our neighbor's tent. Look at our other neighbor's tent. And here is our tent.
Oh my God. It's shallow all the way out to there.
Now it was time to take the tent down.
What time is it?
1:40.
Well, and your top hop up down is pop down.
And with mind aflame, so I wish him strength and length of day.
All right, I've finished my 1,000-mile trek to Kurt Gowdy State Park. I drove 4 hours last night, slept in my car. Iowa State, at Iowa University. Here it is, Kurt Gowdy State Park.
Here's my campsite. $18, because I'm out of state and not from Wyoming. And this is Kurt, the view of my window.
Well, I left Kurt Gowdy State National State Park, and I just crossed over the Conto and the Levi going into Utah. Last night was freezing. It was one of those colds where you have to put your head inside the sleeping bag, and then your breath bothers you because it smells bad and it's hard to breathe. So you have to, like, create a space for your breath. And so, you know, I created a space for my breath. And then it was so damn cold. You wanted your mommy, and you knew that your mommy would make you warm and cuddly. But, you know, your mommy wasn't there, and you just had to make it through the whole night. And finally the dawn broke, and you were up, and it was over. And that's what camping is all about. It was in this moment that the biggest asshole on the trip emerged, Wyoming State Trooper Adams. He looked exactly like Dick Cheney wearing a Mountie hat. In fact, I thought it might be Dick Cheney. I mean, it seemed like, you know, just for fun, Dick Cheney might go out and, like, give people tickets and stuff. It seems like the kind of thing he would do to unwind. And the guy, you know, he was just a real prick. He said, "We enforce the law in Wyoming." I said, "Okay, okay." I said, "How many, you know, with the 75-mile speed limit, how many miles over do you, you know, give people tickets, you know?" He said, 76. I said, "1 mile over?" He said, "We enforce the law." I said, I said, "So if they're going 76, you'd give a person a ticket." He said, "I see that you're smiling, you know, and we enforce the law here. Okay, that's what we're here to do. That's what is smiling illegal in Wyoming also?" I mean, what a prick. I mean, I am certain this guy's wife, Officer Adams, in Evanston, Wyoming, has never had an orgasm.
Salt Lake. No wonder Joseph Smith, in all his wisdom, stopped here. And stopped his wisdom. Apparently, the cops are no good in Utah or Nevada, and I have made it to Harvey's Casino, where we're having dinner at this beautiful lake. And people revere the outdoors and want to be outdoors. It is their religion, which makes them feel great, to commune with God. Sunset.
If you're going to San Francisco.
So as I leave the sensational Lake Tahoe, make it relatively easy, 4-hour ride. I arrive at, yes, I'm about to lose my heart in San Francisco. Yes, I am coming to San Francisco, flowers on my hair. San Francisco is opening its golden gates. This is camping.
San Francisco, open your golden gates.
then came the most difficult moment of the trip, a 3-mile hike straight up.
We had given up. We thank God and hope we would do better than the other sign, when all of a sudden, there was a sign from God again. It was almost like he had stenciled it. We were in the right direction. Summer's will be loving day. Well, I made it back. Free at last, free at last. That was clearly the worst thing I've ever done, is walking up to Booster Roost. Not only will I never hike or bike again, I will never use the word like or the name Mike, and I certainly would never vote for Ike. Back at the car again, this is clearly the worst thing I've ever done, along with everything else. Really special treat for our 35th anniversary, I did treat Marcia to a night at the Motel 6. It was like we were at the Peninsula Hotel, running water, electricity. It was unbelievable.
Here is our beach state park campground. Here's the route that we would take to the beach.
It was a big disappointment. It was like a Japanese internment camp. We decided to get the hell out of there.
And here is the beach. And there is our car before we leave. All right, here is the sanitary district. Right outside the beach campground treatment center, which is actually could be convenient if you had refuse. It would be only, you know, half a block away.
So we set out for LA.
And all the people dressed like monkeys. Let's leave Chicago. That town's a little bit too rugged for you and me, you bad girl. Rolling down Imperial Highway, the big nasty red at my side. Santa Ana winds blowing hot from the north. We were born to ride. Roll down the window, put down the top. Crank up the beach, boys, baby. Don't let the music stop. We go and ride it till we just can't ride it no more. From the side, baby, to the valley. From the west side to the east side.
Biggest crisis in the history of the trip. The car has broken down. I've been towed to this gas station. I'm sleeping in my car. I've been towed to this
gas station who hopefully will be able to repair the car tomorrow at 8 in the morning.
They were unable to fix the car in a day, and so I was stuck in Blythe, California.
And so, while the part was sent for, I spent the day in the best spot in the city is the river, right here. They have this adorable children's thing that goes across the river. Whatever this thing.
Look at that mountain. Look at those trees. Look at that bum over there, man. He's down on his knees. Look at these women. Ain't nothing like them nowhere. Century Boulevard.
We love it.
Victory Boulevard.
We love it.
Santa Monica Boulevard.
We love it.
Sixth Street.
We love it. We love it.
We love it. We love
it. So who knew? My car breaks down, and I find what I was looking for. Remember, in the beginning, I wanted to sit by a river. Well, who knew it was going to be when my car broke down? It was going to be 117 degrees out when I did. But this is what it is. I'm going to stay here for 4 days, and it's almost my total dream, although I could have a better surrounding without this wire and other propensities.
After 3 nights, my car breaking down, and 2 days in Blythe, California, I decided to leave, and I'm not sure why I decided to leave. Afterwards, as I'm on my way through this cactus desert on the way to Sedona, afterwards I realized I hadn't had a single thought the entire time I was in Blythe.
It was like forced meditation. And I'd like to give a shout out to the Blythe Repairing Service. They were spectacular. They were $50 under their estimate. Usually you ripped off in the desert. They were spectacular and they knew exactly what they were doing. They were the greatest. They saved the trip. I love them. I'd like to give a shout out to JJ, my auto psychiatrist in Highwood, Illinois, who I could call at the drop of the hat and always gave me the greatest, smartest, most wonderful advice, that talked to all the car places and did everything I could ever want. And everyone should call JJ's service in Highwood and have him be their psychiatrist.
My thinking is starting to revive, and I'm going into Sedona and expect to see action. I almost stayed in life forever.
Holy shit, look what's up ahead. Red Rock, this is Red Rock Scenic Drive. I'm almost in Sedona.
I just had an encounter with a UFO.
You know, when one door closes, another door opens. And as I left life and wondered why I had done such a thing, I wanted a caravel ice cream the entire trip. And sure enough, there it was at the first gas station. And when I get into Sedona, I saw a sign saying hot dogs. And I've wanted a hot dog for almost 2,000 miles. So I'm now going to have my hot dog.
Verrai, verrai, dovunque arriverai, sei pioggia che gonfia le fontane.
cadrai, cadrai, sul fondo scenderai, nell'anima che scalda gli occhi miei, e ancora ti vorrei, e di notte andar via tra i pensieri lassù.
The choices are getting tough. That's the way to the south rim of the Grand Canyon, and that's the way to Durango, Colorado. It's a 30-mile drive to see the Grand Canyon. I've gone back and forth. At first I didn't care, then I did care, then I found out it was only 29 miles, and I figured that's an hour, I'll go there and I'll take a look. Maybe I'll camp there, maybe I'll stay there, maybe, you know, who knows what'll happen once I get there. But then as I turned down the road, there was a $25 park drive-around fee, and that pissed me off. As I pull away from the Grand Canyon, I feel a little remorse, a little guilt. What am I doing? I'm not going to the Grand Canyon. Everyone goes to the Grand Canyon. I didn't want to Chevy Chase it. I didn't want to just do that. I didn't want to, and I knew I was going to Chevy Chase it. And then $25 to go look at it? I mean, who in the fuck do they think they are? The Grand Canyon? I mean, Blythe was free. And the people were free in Blythe. They were transient. A lot of them were transient. And there was a lot of problems in Blythe. And the cops were doing stings and getting people and stuff like that. And there was no good food or anything to do. But otherwise, Blythe was, like, perfect. And so I was off to Durango, Colorado. Fuck the Grand Canyon.
Ferme intorno a noi, bellissime stelle. Verrai, verrai, dovunque tu sarai, nel vento.
To camp right here, so they put a hotel here, but I want my tent right there. I'm still looking. Here's a bunch of cows to greet me on the Colorado Trail, the trail at the bottom of where I'm camping. I wonder if cows are dangerous.
We know that cops are dangerous. As I enjoyed the serenity of the cows, I had no idea I was only a mile away from where Rick Wysocki, I knew his name now, would be lurking the following morning as I came down from my peaceful campsite and waiting with his police, his futuristic helmet and lights and spacecraft of a motorcycle lurking to give a ticket to a camper 36 for going 36 miles an hour in a 25 zone. This mindless zombie, this stoop who worked for the police state in Durango, Colorado, Rick Wysocki. And now I had a deferred ticket. Deferred meant you had to not get another ticket in 120 days, or you had to pay for both of them. So I had to get out of Colorado as fast as I could.
heading towards the Rocky Mountains themselves. The Big Daddy all together, the Big Kahuna, the reason we're all in Colorado. And my final stop in this miraculous journey. We left the desert and now it looks like low mountains with beautiful trees everywhere and rivers, and there's actually people living here. Wildflowers on both sides of the road as we come into Colorado as we approach the Rocky Mountains. And I'd also like to say something for a second. I mean, you're on a trip, you should have a first aid kit. I thought that before I started, but it never came into play. Now I realize it's important. You never know when you're challenging the elements. You never know when you're gonna need the first aid kit. And I had a very serious injury with my sandal strap. Did not take well to my inner toe, big toe and first toe, and created a blister with pus, and it was red and kind of deep and everything, and I was able to clean it out with those napkins like they serve you at rip joints, and then put a nice antibiotic on it. It was like by nice, I mean it was mushy, it was like Vaseline, but it had good things in it for you. This could be the first glimpse of the Rocky Mountains, but I don't think so. I'm too far from Denver, but maybe it's the beginning of it. They're definitely going up higher there. Rocky Mountain High, Colorado. Rocky Mountain High, Colorado.
He was born in the summer of his 27th year.
This must be the little bitty baby Rocky Mountains, the real Rocky Mountains, the one that we're all here to see, or must be up ahead.
To a place he'd never been before. He left yesterday behind him. You might say he was born again.
Rocky Mountain High, Colorado. Rocky Mountain High, Colorado. That's got to be the rock. That wasn't the Rocky Mountains. It wasn't even a major mountain. Where the hell are the Rocky Mountains?
When he first came to the mountains, his life was far away. On the road, hanging by a song.
That must be it. Beer commercial, but so is this one. I have no idea now which ones are the Rocky Mountains or the Coors Beer commercial, and I won't have any confidence about it until I Google it and find out exactly where they are and see where I was.
So I arrived at my friend's house in Boulder, and this is where he lives. It's exactly my dream. He lives on the water. The water is rushing by. One could frolic. That's going to be my room right there. Here's the house over here. So he's exactly living my dream life every day.
He saw everything as far as you can see. And they say that he got crazy once.
Well, as I leave, there's, you can see, barely Denver in the distance, and the Rocky Mountains are behind. Maybe in the mirror you can see it. And maybe that mirror. And I never found the Rocky Mountains. I can't believe I came to Colorado and couldn't find the Rocky Mountains, but I didn't. And that's what camping's all about. Because you know, sometimes the goals aren't the thing, it's the journey.
Rocky Mountain High, Colorado. Rocky Mountain High, Colorado.
Yee-hoo!
I'm leaving, getting the fuck out of Colorado. I only hope that the karma catches up with this son of a bitch.
I was feeling really good. I was getting out of Colorado, and I wouldn't be there for another 120 days, so my ticket would be deferred when I heard a rock hit my windshield and looked over and saw a crack. Here's what my buddy said when I told him.
Yeah. Whoo! Yeah!
A minute and 20 seconds.